I love the red letter Bible. In fact, one of my favorite portions of scripture, I often quote to myself and I often quote to other people who are really in need. And these are the red letter words of Jesus that I love in John chapter 8, verse 31 to 32 and verse 36. And I'm sure most of you know them well. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." And verse 36 says, "So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." What is this indeed freedom that Jesus speaks of? What is this kind of truth that really sets free? And as I started thinking about this, I realized that we all inside of us have a deep-seated need for freedom. Let's give some examples. The need to be able to free, to express yourself, the freedom of expression. That is the freedom to express your views freely, to agree or to disagree with someone else's point of view, and the freedom to do so without the fear of ridicule or persecution. But is that free limitless? Is that freedom limitless? No. We all know that if you proclaim hate speech, for example, it becomes a punishable offense. So there's a limit to that freedom. What about freedom of association, which is the freedom to associate with anyone we want to form associations of like-minded people and to do so freely without being ostracized or branded by another association of people who differ to your views? And once again, is that a limitless freedom? No. We don't have the right to belong. We don't have the freedom to belong to a terrorist organization and not be persecuted and not be prosecuted for that. And yet we have all got this deep-seated need for freedom in our hearts. Freedom from political oppression. What about the freedom of movement? The freedom to go wherever you want to, whenever you want to, and do whatever you want to. No wonder the worst kind of a punishment in our law today is the imprisonment of a prisoner. Now, I know that even though modern prisons are much better than they used to be in the old days, they have libraries, they have television, they have educational opportunities, better food than before. If you go and speak to any one of those prisoners who are incarcerated, and you give them the option of keeping one of those so-called luxuries or exchanging it for their freedom, everyone will say, "I want my freedom." The bottom line is that we were all born with a deep inner longing for freedom. Have you ever asked yourself, where does this longing come from? To what extent does it have boundaries? What did Jesus mean when Jesus said these words, "He who the Son sets free is free indeed"? Does it mean that we can do anything we want to, whenever we want to, go wherever we want to once we meet Jesus? Let's find out. And the message today is titled, "Real and Lasting Freedom." Now, in order to understand what Jesus meant in those three verses that I quoted in John 8, verse 31 to 32 and verse 36, one has to look at what he had in mind when you see the recorded scripture in the entire John chapter 8. So to give you a little bit of an overview to understand why this is a very important passage for us today, the chapter starts off right in the beginning of chapter 8, where the scribes and the Pharisees bring a woman caught in adultery into the temple and put her in front of Jesus in order to test him, in order to find some reason to lay charges against him. And then they remind him of the law of Moses that commanded that such woman be stoned, and then they put him to the test. And they say, "Jesus, so what do you say?" Jesus had the unique way of turning people's questions back upon themselves. And so he kneels down and he starts writing in on the ground. And I can just imagine the puzzlement there must have been with these religious leaders. and the tension in the air. And then he gets up and he turns their test into a self-examination, and he says the following: let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. And I'm sure you could have heard a pin drop, because Jesus then again bends down and he starts writing on the ground again. And he gives them the opportunity, the time to reflect on the condition of their own hearts. And gradually, and probably one by one, the accusers all eventually leave the scene. And Jesus then gets up, looks at the woman, sees that it's him and her alone. And then he forgives her sin by saying, nor do I condemn you. But he doesn't leave her there. He also then gives her her own test. And her own test is, go and sin no more. And it struck me as I read that the grace and forgiveness of Jesus is free. But never ever mistake it for being cheap. Because what Jesus was saying is, your sin is forgiven. You are now free. But you are not free to resume your old ways of life. Now, as we continue reading in John chapter 8, the text doesn't tell us where the next batch of religious leaders came from, because the first batch left with that self-examination that Jesus gave them. But in the rest of this chapter, we see they're back in force, and they are arguing and contesting with Jesus to test him about his true identity and purpose. And Jesus continually keeps turning their questions back upon themselves. It became quite a heated and a very frank debate. In fact, they called themselves, we are sons of Abraham. And Jesus calls them, no, you are sons of the devil. And then they turn and they say to Jesus, you are demon possessed. And right at the end of the chapter, in verse 59, Jesus finally reveals his true identity. And he says in verse 59, before Abraham was, I am. And that was like waving a red flag to a bull, because these religious leaders immediately knew what Jesus was saying. Jesus was referring back to the fact that when Moses met with God at the foot of Mount Sinai in the burning bush, that's the way God Almighty revealed himself to Moses, by saying, I am that I am, is what you tell the people that are sending you to free them out of slavery. So when they heard Jesus identifying himself as God, they wanted to stone him for blasphemy. But at the end of the chapter, we simply read, but Jesus hid himself and left the temple. That's at the beginning and that's at the end. But smack bang, in the middle of this verbal and this spiritual duel, we find this portion of scripture that we will be looking at this evening together. And once again, we find it's not a surprise that Jesus is testing hearts. And I know that even as he tested hearts of his hearers then, he's testing every one of our hearts, including my heart, again today. And I trust that every one of us will listen and be open to the prompting of the Holy Spirit and to the power of the Word this evening. In October 2018, in Port Elizabeth, in South Africa. So what is the difference between the freedom that Jesus says lasts, the real and lasting freedom, and the other kinds of freedom, the senses of freedom, that do not last at all? We'll be reading this portion together again from verse 30 to 36 of John 8. And listen to what Jesus was saying. As he was saying these things, many believed in him. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And they answered him, we are offspring of Abraham. We've never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? And Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever, but the son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Why do I say this is a test? Because if you look at the portion we just read, who was Jesus speaking to? In verse 30, he says, as he was saying these things, many believed in him. Verse 31 says, so Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him. In other words, Jesus was speaking to those who believed in him, to those who believed him. This test was a test of real discipleship, of real truth, of real freedom. This then means that Jesus knew when he spoke to that audience that there were real disciples and curious followers, that there was real truth and partial truth. There was real freedom and partial freedom. So to help us this evening to measure our own lives as we explore real and lasting freedom, let's look at these three things in more detail. Real discipleship, real truth, and real freedom. What did Jesus have in mind when he spoke these words? Firstly, real discipleship. There's a significant difference between, on the one hand, believing in Jesus as Lord and Savior and in the full truth of his word, and believing, on the other hand, the facts about him as a wise and influential historical figure. Jesus said, real disciples, true disciples, abide in his word. What did he mean? Because Jesus didn't just assume that everyone really believed. Truly believe. He set out this test for real belief. When Jesus said in verse 31, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. It's remarkable when you look there, he doesn't say if you abide in my words. He says if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. What did he mean? He meant that if you abide in, if you trust in, fully immerse yourself in every single minute of your day, in everything he says about himself, about his identity as the Son of God, as the Savior of the world, as the Lord of your life, as all his teachings, all his promises, all his commands. He's saying that you are truly my disciples if you abide in my word. In other words, if you constantly believe in, constantly remain in, constantly live in, constantly persevere in my word for every circumstance and season of your life, whether good or bad, pleasant or unpleasant, easy or difficult, whether on a mountaintop or in a valley, in a time of peace or in the middle of a raging storm, whether you feel like it or not. Why do you think this persistent believing, abiding, persevering in his word is so important to Jesus, no matter what? Because if you look at his words, Jesus does not say that if you abide in my word, you will truly become my disciples. No. He says, if you abide in my word, you truly are my disciples. In other words, the true discipleship, true devotion, true trust and faith in Jesus Christ and his word is evidence of our abiding, of our day-to-day perseverance in faith in him no matter what. It is through our daily abiding and trusting in him and his word fully and completely that it becomes evident that we are truly his disciples. I want to use an example to illustrate. In the previous century, there was a world-famous acrobat by the name of Jean-Francois Gravelet, known by his stage name of Blondine. And during his career, he crossed the Niagara Falls on a tightrope quite a few times. And the tightrope was approximately 300 meters long and 50 meters above the deafening, roaring, crashing, cascading waters of the Niagara Falls. And once he pushed a wheelbarrow across. On another occasion, he walked to the middle of the crossing and cooked an omelet. And in an unusual demonstration of his skills, Blondin once carried a man across on his shoulders and back. And when he came to the cheering crowds after this death-defying walk, he asked the man who was nearby, "Do you believe I can carry you across?" To which the man replied, "Of course, I saw you carry a man across and back." To which Blondin replied, "Well, hop on, and I'll carry you across." Not on your life, replied the man. There's an element of where this example shows the difference between a real disciple of Jesus and a false disciple. The difference between real trust and faith in Jesus as opposed to an intellectual agreement with effect. Another way of putting it in our context today is this. Is Jesus truly Lord of every area of my life? Or do I think I am still in control of some of my own life? Do I feel I want to retain the freedom to do whatever I want to do, whenever I want to do? Or do we trust Him fully and completely, whether we feel like it or not? Do we have faith in Him and in His full word, no matter what trial or challenge we might be facing? Because Jesus made it very clear what He meant in John chapter 15 about the true vine. He said this, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." Real discipleship, lasting fruit, comes from a life of abiding in and total trust in Christ and the fullness of His word. That's what Jesus meant by true and real discipleship. So what about real truth? It gets better. Directly after saying that if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, Jesus then says, "And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Meaning that over and above true discipleship that is evident from true abiding and trust in Jesus and His word, we will also know the real truth and will experience the freedom of knowing the real truth and the benefits of such real truth. What is this truth that Jesus speaks of? What is this truth that sets free? Jesus made it clear in John 14, verse 6, when He spoke to one of His disciples by the name of Thomas, and He said to him the well-known words in John 14, verse 6, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus said, "I am the very embodiment of truth. I am the true way, the true life, the only truth, the only way, and the only life that can bring you the freedom that you need. I'm the only one who can bring you to the Father, the real freedom that you all have, that you're all aching and longing for in your hearts." And the same Apostle John, who wrote this gospel that we're preaching about today, he witnessed the truth personally and listened to how he put it in John chapter 1 verse 14. He said, "And the Word became flesh." The Word there with a capital W, speaking about Jesus, the truth. And he said, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen His glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." John says, we saw Him. We walked with Him. We saw His miracles. We heard His life-changing word. Man, He is all that He says He is. That's why I wrote this gospel. He says we got to know Him intimately as the real truth, the ultimate truth. In fact, the one who showed amazing grace and love to us by bridging this impossible gap, this impossible gulf between us and Father God, a gulf of sin and separation that no man could ever cross on his or her own. You see, knowing the truth is not just knowing about Him, but knowing Him intimately, putting our faith and trust in Him completely, because He's the only one who can take us from this side of the divide to the other side of the divide. No man could ever do this. He became a bridge for us between ourselves and our old state in sin and Father God and the wonderful benefit of being there. He paid the penalty for our sin. That's the real truth Jesus was referring to. But you know the interesting thing about this truth is that it goes much wider and much deeper and much higher than our wildest imagination. Because once we have crossed over, once Jesus has taken us across something that was impossible for us to do, when we find ourselves in the other side, in the land of promise, we all know as believers that our life is not easy. Our life is not without its challenges, without its tribulations, without its trials, when we reach the other side where Jesus takes us to. But this is what C.S. Lewis says. And you must need to understand that once you cross over, the Word of God says, everything changes on the other side. This is how C.S. Lewis put it. He said, I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it I see everything else. In other words, what he was saying is, once you have seen, once you have believed in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, once He has taken you on this incredible journey from this side of the Great Divide to the other side of the Great Divide, you get to a place where not only do you see Him and what He's done with you, but as you grow in your intimacy with Him, He changes the way you see everything around you, the way you do everything around you. Living from a foundation of total truth and trust in Him and growing in our relationship with Him as the real truth opens our eyes, and we start seeing our daily lives and the world around us through His eyes. When we get there, on the other side, this is what Peter said about Christ. Peter, one of the other apostles, in 2 Peter 1 verse 3, he says, His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Some things? No, it says all things. Granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us to His own glory and excellence. Another way of putting it is, it's by growing in our relationship with Him. It's by growing in our knowledge of Him, by growing in our understanding of who He is and the power that He makes available to us, that we know that He enables us to live a godly life of influence wherever He has placed us. Not only has He paid the penalty for our sin, but He's given us the ability, the power, the divine enabling power to live in victory over sin. Is sin still present in the world? Yes. But the truth that sets free is to know that He's paid the penalty for my sin, but He's also given me the divine enabling power to live in victory over sin. That's real truth. That's what Jesus had in mind with these words. Real discipleship, real truth. What about real freedom? Jesus said, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. We've already seen from the context that Jesus made the statement intentionally to test the understanding of freedom that His hearers had. Listen to their response. They answered Him in verse 33, we're offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? See, the answer of these people reveals that a few things about them. Firstly, they were still busy trying to question Jesus, still busy testing Jesus, still trying to trip Him up. Secondly, these hearers clearly did not have the same understanding of the kind of freedom that Jesus was speaking of. Thirdly, if you read it properly, you'll see they were not referring to political freedom because they were at that time under Roman rule at the time. This is what they thought. They thought, we are free as offspring of Abraham, as part of God's chosen race. While in the meanwhile, the real truth was staring them in the face. And I couldn't help but think in my own life how pride, self-importance, status, and accomplishments can sometimes blind us to the truth, even if the truth is staring us in the face. Because Jesus continues, and He explains what He had in mind with regard to this real freedom that He spoke of. As He said in verse 34 to 36, then Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. For Jesus, the ultimate slavery is not slavery to a political system, but slavery to sin. And to be a slave to sin is to be under the power and the rule of sin. It means that you are imprisoned by sin. You cannot resist that impulse, that habit, that temptation. You simply do not have the power to resist. Whilst the Jewish audience felt spiritually confident that they were free as sons of Abraham, Jesus in reality pointed out to them that they were slaves, imprisoned to sin, and desperately in need of true freedom. In fact, they still found themselves on this side of the great divide. Then we see a very interesting sentence. What did Jesus mean when he said that the slave does not remain in the house forever, but the son remains forever? I believe that because the Jews were referring to themselves as sons of Abraham, Jesus was probably pointing out to them, whoa, Isaac was the son of God's promise in Abraham's house, and that he would remain in the father's house forever through the promise made to Abraham. But the other son, whose name was Ishmael, was born to a slave woman and would not have remained in the father's house and would never have inherited the promises of his father. Then if you think about it like that, the meaning of Jesus becomes clearer. This is what Jesus said. He was in fact saying to them that you might regard yourselves as offspring of Abraham, but the promises of Abraham belong to the seed of Abraham. And the seed of Abraham are the sons and daughters of faith, and they inherit true freedom through faith. Abraham, remember, was primarily remembered as the father of faith. And it was his faith that was counted him as righteousness, not his ability to keep the law. In fact, only one person ever was able to keep the law person, only one human being, and that was Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who is called the true seed of Abraham, with a capital S. So Jesus made it clear that you're either a slave in the house of sin on this side of the divide, or a son in the house of freedom on the other side of the divide. You've either been regenerated, justified, adopted by God as his sons and daughter in his family through faith in Jesus Christ, or you're still in slavery to the power of sin. Your chains are either gone or you're still shackled. Jesus was saying, I'm the only one who can take you from this side to the other. I'm the only one who can unlock the chains of sin. He says that on this side, your master is sin. On that side, I am your master. We all have a deep-seated longing for freedom. Real and lasting freedom means that we need to remind ourselves, if you're still on this side of the divide, I want to invite you, don't stay there, because Jesus is calling you to the other side of the divide. If you find yourself on the other side, being taken there by the grace and love and mercy of an incredible God and Savior, if you find yourself there, you need to understand that Jesus paid the penalty for sin. This is why Paul addressed sons and daughters in the house of freedom. In Romans 8 verse 1 to 3, he says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. The only way is to understand that Jesus is the bridge across the great divide. But now again, if you find yourself in the land of forgiveness, in the land of victory over sin, we need to ask ourselves the question, do we still sin? Oh, come on, let's be real about this. Paul says in Romans chapter 3, he says, All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And if you go and have a look at what the same John said in his first epistle, he said, if you say that you have no sin, you make God to be a liar. So what happens on the other side of the great divide when we struggle with all these temptations, all these things that come our way, all these things that want to distract us, all these things that want to take us away from a life of holiness before God? What happens? This is how Paul put it in Galatians 5 verse 1. He says, for freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not again submit to a yoke of slavery. In Romans 6, Paul puts it like this. So you must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Real and lasting freedom is a gift packaged in the person, the word, and the work of Jesus Christ. Abiding in him and in his word is real discipleship, because he is the real truth, and through him we have real and lasting freedom. I end with this. You all have received this Connect card. And for those who don't know what this is a yoke for oxen. And this yoke speaks of the kind of freedom that Jesus had in mind. Now, an ox, the two oxen would be spanned in together, and they would be led by the master of the oxen wherever he wanted them to go. He would put the load on that they would carry. He gave them their new identity and their purpose in this world. This is what Jesus said himself in Matthew 11, verse 28 to 30. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The freedom that Jesus speaks of, the true and lasting freedom, is not the freedom to do whatever you want, to go wherever you want to and say whatever you want to. It's to do what he wants, to go where he wants. And he has placed every one of us as his light. And he says, let your light shine in such a way that others will see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. You see, the wonderful thing about that side of the great divide is that even though he's given us this ability to walk in victory to sin, we now live in a land of hope, a hope that nothing and no one will ever be able to take away from us. Because we all know that even though we have been relieved from the penalty of sin, and we've even been given by Jesus the potential, the power, the divine enabling power to overcome sin, we know that sin is still present in the world. But I've got good news for you. This is our hope, that one day the same King will return, and all sin and all tears and all fear and all hardship will be gone. That's a hope that also centers in the freedom that Jesus speaks of, a freedom not just in this world, but a freedom that extends into all eternity. If you are struggling with sin in your life still, if you're holding on to that, tonight I want to make an invitation to you as Jesus calls you by name and says, don't stay on this side of the divide where you are trapped by your master called sin. I'm calling you across. Repent of that sin. Repentance means turning away from your sin and then walking towards the only one who is able to take you into the land of forgiveness. And then there are some this evening who are struggling still with that habitual sin that keeps coming back at you, keeps coming back. I want to encourage you. Jesus is calling you as well and saying, you need to now in this moment make a decision. Say, Lord, I cannot do this by myself. Because I want to tell you, you cannot conquer sin on your own. It's not possible. Jesus said so. He said, I have given you the divine enabling power to overcome that sin. But it starts with an abiding in me. It comes from an empowerment that can only come by an intimate relationship with me. And I have good news. He who the Son has set free is free indeed. And you know, he indwells in us. The Spirit of God lives in us. And when that temptation comes, the Word of God says he provides the way out. He firstly gives you the ability to resist that temptation, but he also provides the way out. And I also want to say, for some who are skating very close to the margin of sin, create some margin in your life. Don't go to places where you are in that temptation. We pray the Lord's Prayer, and the Lord's Prayer is, lead us not into temptation. Do you really believe God is going to lead you into temptation? The Spirit of God is going to show you, oh, don't go there. But it comes from a place of intimacy, a relationship with him. And we will know the freedom that Jesus spoke of. And the world will look at that freedom and say, I want some of that. In fact, I want it all. And his name is Jesus.